freedom of speech.
Fundamental rights.
Freedom of conscience.
Academic freedom.
Freedom of press.
And the right to listen.
You're listening to So to Speak, the free speech podcast, brought to you by FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education.
Welcome back. This is Nico Perino. I'm your host for So to Speak, the free speech podcast, where we take an uncensored look at the world of free expression through personal stories and candid conversations. On February 13th, we at FIRE celebrated our 10th consecutive victory in our unprecedented and thus far undefeated Stand Up for Speech litigation project. What happened was a three-judge panel of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Eighth Circuit unanimously upheld a federal district court's decision to permanently bar Iowa State University from using its trademark policy to prevent a campus student group from printing t-shirts advocating marijuana legalization. The decision was our project's first decision from a federal court of appeals, so it was a really big deal. The ruling demonstrates how when students and faculty members step up to challenge their college's speech codes, they win. But challenging your school's policy in court can be scary. So today we're going to talk with Rob Corry. He's a lawyer in Colorado who in 1994 joined with eight Stanford students to challenge a Stanford speech code. We're going to talk with Rob about what inspired him to file the lawsuit, what worried him about suing his school, how campus responded to his lawsuit, and what the eventual court victory on February 27th, 1995, so 22 years ago this month, meant to him, and also what it meant to Stanford and to the national conversation about free speech on campus. I'm excited because for today's conversation, I'm joined by Joe Cohn. Joe is FIRE's legislative and policy director. He is making his So to Speak premiere, and he is the man who originally introduced me to Rob. So, Joe, thanks for coming on the show.
Nico, thank you so much for having me.
So, Joe, this was an important speech code decision, this Corry v. Stanford decision. Why?
Well, it's a very important decision. It's one of the early decisions striking down a speech code, and in many ways it was ahead of its time because it's a case that's decided in 1995, several years before the United States Supreme Court defined peer-on-peer harassment, which set forth when speech loses its protection in a higher education and actually an education context to become actionable. So that's really a very important feature of the case. But the second thing that's really important about the case is that it's the first time that a court applies First Amendment principles to a private institution, in this instance, using the California statute that's now called the Leonard Law, which says that private non-sectarian institutions can't censor speech that would be protected at public institutions.
And it's the only California is the only state in the country that has this sort of law.
It is.
All right. So let's bring Rob Corry on the show and we'll talk to him about what was the inspiration for the challenge to the speech code, why it's such an important decision, and how he's taken his activism in college and applied it in his postgraduate years. So Rob, thanks for joining us on the show today.
Sure. Thanks for having me.
So
and happy President's Day, by the way.
Yeah, happy President's Day.
It's nice to have a holiday honoring Donald Trump.
Now you're a lawyer, right? So you have this day off. The courts are closed.
Technically, it is a court holiday, but I'm sitting here in my office catching up on paperwork anyway, and our receptionist is gone, so it's a quiet day and getting a lot done.
All right, great. So let's go back to your speech code battle back in the 1990s. Can you set the scene for us on May 2nd, 1994, when you filed your lawsuit? What was the environment for free speech like at Stanford in particular, but also across the country?
Sure. And there's even a bigger lead up to when we filed the lawsuit, which was kind of our last resort, honestly. The lead up to that is I was a elected student government senator representing the law school in Stanford's overall student government, and most of the students did not like the speech code, and these are students of all political stripes at the time. This was largely an administration thing responding to a very vocal minority that wanted the speech code, numerical minority of students. And so we worked with the Student Senate to get a bill introduced, And we actually had a majority of student senators as co-sponsors of the bill. And so it was heard at one of our student senate meetings. And lo and behold, at that meeting, the president of the university, Gerhard Casper, showed up, who's also a constitutional law professor, brilliant man, and you know, made a defense of the speech code and persuaded enough senators, even co-sponsors of this bill, to vote against it. So there are a lot of thoughts that come up from that. You know, if you co-sponsor a bill, generally you're supposed to vote for it, but that didn't happen. So this bill failed in the student senate. And, you know, we wanted to work within the system to repeal the speech code, but that wasn't possible. So then a group of us decided, well, what's our next step here? And we were familiar with the law at the time in California, which is still the law, the Leonard Law, that imposes First Amendment standards on private universities.
And I'm going to jump in right there real quickly because it's an important thing for our listeners to understand. The courts have established very clearly for decades now that the First Amendment applies in full force at public institutions of higher education. So it's unique in California that they have a statute that prohibits censorship of students at private institutions of higher education through the Leonard Law that you just mentioned.
It is. It is a unique law. And, you know, there are good arguments for and against it from a liberty free speech standpoint. Incidentally, Stanford didn't know how to make those arguments against the Leonard Law. You know, that the private sector has some is different from the public sector. But at any rate, our goal as students and my goal as a litigator was to use the tools that were available to us to, you know, strike down the speech code. So the Leonard Law, which is, I think, still unique in the United States, although Colorado is looking to pass something similar to it, applied First Amendment standards to a private university like Stanford, which was to the betterment of the university, unquestionably. And the atmosphere, to answer your question, on campus was, you know, unfortunately, things haven't changed much since 1994, but it was this stifling political correctness. You know, with or without the speech code, it was a political correctness that was peer enforced, and you know, shaming people. There was a big incident my first year of law school where a first year law student was walking home drunk by the dorms and shouted some things against a RA who happened to be homosexual, and you know, this little drunken escapade landed on the front page of the Stanford Daily day after day. You know, a bunch of law students took out a full-page ad in the Stanford Daily. I was not one of them. I'm proud that I, you know, resisted all the peer pressure to sign this ad. And this first-year law student, who was a good student, smart guy, was hounded out of Stanford Law School. I mean, he moved on to a different law school after his first year because of this one drunken escapade. So this is the atmosphere on campus, and it was to the point where a person really was afraid to make even a reasoned, substantial, substantive political argument against, say, affirmative action, because it could be interpreted as criticizing a person for their race and therefore a violation of the speech code. And you know,
well, can you give our listeners an understanding of what the speech code said?
Yes, the speech code prohibited basically insults based on certain characteristics, and the laundry list was race, gender, religion, national origin, sexual orientation. So you could insult somebody's mother, for example, but you couldn't insult somebody based on those certain characteristics. And given the atmosphere, I mean, those characteristics are pretty broad and encompass a lot of political things, but, you know, this could reasonably be seen to affect discussions about all sorts of political issues, affirmative action, civil rights, abortion, criminal law. You know, most of these issues have some element of race, gender, religion, national origin. I mean, we can't even have a religious discussion on a campus. And so what it did, and it was rarely invoked, if ever, to censor a student formally, but it exerted a chilling effect on students, and people did not want to be expelled. Go figure, you know. So they censored their own speech, and this is on top of this political correctness that already permeates.
And you know, we see the chilling effect in speech codes all of the time. And what was to us so impressive about your challenge was that you were able to pinpoint how that speech code targeted not just the kind of conduct that truly is harassing, but was overbroad to bring in conduct that we don't want to prohibit and speech we don't want to prohibit because it is, in fact, protected. And if I recall correctly, the actual speech code talked about harassment in terms of personal vilification of a student based on the traits that you listed. So that's pretty broad.
It sure is. And I think we all know how it could play out because it's the effect on the listener. And it was a complaint-driven process, or would have been. And so if somebody was in a discussion and one person didn't like the other person's views, that person could then report the offender under the speech code. And as we all know how campus discipline works, I mean, you're guilty until proven innocent. And of course, we know also the viewpoint discriminatory nature of the speech code. I mean, the prevailing orthodoxy from the administration and faculty is overwhelmingly left liberal. And so, of course, everyone knew that it was only going to be enforced one way.
You know, at FIRE, we deal with that problem all of the time, and we tend to think through this issue of the line between when speech is clearly protected and when it becomes conduct that loses its protection because it's peer-on-peer harassment. And we view it through the lens of what the courts have said over the years. You know, in 1999, the Supreme Court defining peer-on-peer harassment in a case called Davis versus Monroe County Board of Education. But when I think back through your challenge, you didn't have the benefit of that case law yet because it didn't exist. We're talking 1995, a few years before the Supreme Court had weighed in.
Yep. We did have the RAV case, which was a big one for us, and we structured our lawsuit around that.
For our non-lawyer listeners, can you describe that case and the findings?
Sure. RAV is a person's initials, and that case dealt with laws criminalizing cross burning, and you know, somebody burned a cross in St. Paul, Minnesota, and was prosecuted for it, and then struck down that law because burning a cross was free speech protected. So, you know, we did have that case, and obviously that's an extreme case, and most First Amendment law is extreme. I mean, you don't need protections for popular speech, so that's why the vast majority of the case law centers around unpopular speech, controversial speech, which is the point of the First Amendment. So we had that case, and then the university centered its arguments around the Chaplinsky versus New Hampshire case, which was, you know, this kind of outlier case that
fighting words doctrine.
Right. It said that the government could prosecute fighting words that were designed to invoke a violent response. And
what's so crazy about that case is that it's talking about a citizen calling a law enforcement officer a fascist pig. Or a fascist.
And like a goddamn racketeer or something.
Or a goddamn racketeer. And the court decides that any reasonable, you know, person being called those names would lash out in violence. That a law enforcement person wouldn't be able to restrain themselves with that kind of incitement. So it is
amazing too, the way history is going, because these days in the United States, it seems like cops get called fascists on a daily basis, if not hourly basis. And, people seem to, cops are, to their credit, usually able to just blow that off, you know?
But, you know, it's also just trained. It's also just a very political issue that underscores how that kind of commentary is at the heart of the First Amendment, of dealing with people's relationship with the government where they're in fact interacting with the government on a direct basis.
Yeah, I would argue that the Chaplinsky case has been basically overruled by common sense over the years. I don't think anybody believes the holding of it anymore. It's lost its validity, kind of like when Justice O'Connor says affirmative action has to expire in 25 years, which is coming up, by the way. That's coming up pretty soon.
Yeah, and regardless of how you feel about law enforcement, the ability to weigh those feelings out publicly is really at the core of what it means to be a free society.
It really is.
So I want to chime in here, because the argument that the school was making was that this speech code only targeted fighting words. And from my understanding, reading through the history of this case, there were law professors involved who were trying to stick closely to that doctrine. And then your argument was that it didn't really match the fighting words doctrine, or that doctrine had mostly expired, and you're citing cases like RAV. What the discussion over the speech code, and the speech code was introduced in 1990, if I'm correct?
That's correct.
It happened over an 18-month period, and it sounded like the conversation surrounding the speech code on campus was very robust. Was this a conversation, not with particular focus on Stanford speech code, but nationally, were there conversations about speech codes in the early 90s? And who were leading those conversations?
There sure were conversations, and I arrived at Stanford in 1991, so I was not present on campus for the debate about whether to have a speech code. Of course, I researched it. You know, there were all kinds of views on all sides of it.
There was no fire at the time.
Right, true. And had fire been involved, Stanford might not have even gone that direction with a speech code. And there were professors, you know, on the left who were credible First Amendment scholars who said this is a bad idea. And, you know, the prevailing political orthodoxy of the day came through. But it was part of this national conversation, too. You had the book a few years earlier, The Closing of the American Mind, which focused on campus political correctness, and that book was a revelation and brought this issue to the fore. But the big issue with the speech code, and going back to something you said, it was based on this fighting words doctrine, but it was only it only carved out a certain preferred type of fighting words, you know, and that's what the court honed in on too, that it didn't even apply the Chaplinsky precedent properly, because it only said these types of fighting words are prohibited. So it was arguably underbroad, because it didn't prohibit all types of fighting words.
And that was a really fatal flaw of that speech code, was that it really didn't match what it was trying to get at. And you know, and I talk, you know, in my role as FIRE's legislative and policy director, I'm talking to university general counsels, but also lawmakers across the country all the time, and I'm talking to them about how schools do have a legitimate reason to have some very narrowly tailored restrictions on speech. But when they try to justify those restrictions, they need to make sure that their solutions that they pose and the regulations that they pitch really do match the problem they're describing. So, for example, if you had you have a library on your campus, you might have a legitimate reason to not want amplified sound and loud protests outside the library, you know, at night. But that can't possibly be used to justify a permitting requirement that says that someone has to get permission 2 weeks in advance before they can hand out copies of literature to, you know, to a fellow student.
Right. And the way Stanford structured it is, to use this analogy, I mean, you could have the late night protest outside of a library if it was to protest certain topics, but you couldn't have it if it were to protest other topics. I mean, they tried to carve out certain topics that were off limits, and even though we didn't need to prove this, it seemed clear to everybody that it was not only certain topics, but even ideologies from a certain side that were the targets of this speech code. And it was also called the gray interpretation of the fundamental standard. The fundamental standard is this overarching kind of general rule at Stanford that has existed since the inception, where, you know, students are supposed to be courteous to each other and that sort of thing. Language of the late 1800s. And then Tom Gray.
And Gray was a person. It wasn't there to imply the vagueness of the policy.
Right. Yeah, Tom Gray. It wasn't like Gray Areas. That was his name, Professor Tom Gray, who was a law professor, and he authored the speech code. And he didn't call it a speech code. He resisted that term. But it really was a speech code, and the court used that term as well.
Well, they never call them speech codes. They call them, you know, harassment policies. They call them computer use policies. They call them distribution policies. But and they sound innocuous, but they really are talking about what you're allowed to say, when you're allowed to say it, and who you're allowed to say it to, and the tone you have to use when you say it.
Exactly. All at threat of expulsion or suspension.
Yeah.
This was not a feel-good, friendly thing. I mean, Tom Gray repeatedly argued, well, this causes a, you know, positive campus atmosphere, and it actually increases free speech because people feel safer. I mean, this was the genesis of this whole safe spaces thing, which has, you know, metastasized since 1994, 95 to a much greater degree. I mean, unfortunately, it seems like we're worse off now, even though the schools don't use straight speech codes as much as maybe they used to. Unfortunately, it has not gotten better.
Oh, they use plenty of them. We have 93% of universities still maintain at least one policy that wouldn't be constitutional, according to the latest research in our Spotlight database. And if you haven't checked that out, to all of the listeners, you can find it on our website, www.thefire.org.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Rob, was the speech code in response to something, or was it a solution in search of a problem?
The latter. There really wasn't any incident or issue that it was in response to. I think it was just the proponents would say this is a proactive preventive measure, which, you know, but like so many things, they just kind of made it up.
Yeah. I want to talk about the genesis of your decision to file the lawsuit, because you filed the lawsuit along with 8 other students, and you represented the students in this lawsuit. You represented yourself. Is that correct?
I did, yeah. I was a third-year law student, not admitted to the bar of any state, including California. So technically, I mean, looking back on this, I should not have been able to represent these other students, because being a lawyer, that's what a lawyer is able to do, is represent others in cases. Now, of course, everybody has a right to represent himself or herself pro se without being a lawyer, but I probably shouldn't have been able to represent these other 8 plaintiffs who were all Stanford students.
We won't tell on you, and I think the statute of limitations has probably passed.
That was an argument that Stanford should have made, which didn't.
Along with the standing argument, to Stanford's credit.
Right. I mean, they made some good arguments. There's no question. You know, once we filed this lawsuit, and it is hard to sue your university. It's hard to do it in a nice manner. We sent a couple really nice, polite, respectful letters saying, you know, please rescind this speech code. Here's why it runs afoul of the Leonard Law. You know, we'd rather not sue you. And we were sincere about that. We did not want to sue our school. Some people thought they'd withhold my diploma if I did that, because I was a month or two away from graduation.
Well, it takes a lot of courage to do it. And we know that pretty well, because we launched our Stand Up for Speech project, where we work with students to challenge speech codes, just a couple of years ago. And, you know, we have to talk to students about, you know, the pluses and minuses of challenging their institutions, because there's a lot at stake.
There really is. And most people at Stanford have ambitions in life. I mean, it's, you know, suing your school is a pretty radical move. In our case, I think we really found strength in numbers, and that was the key. Had I been alone out there, one plaintiff, That would have been a lot more scary. Had any one of these individual plaintiffs been alone out there, it would have been difficult. But the nine of us, there were strength in numbers, and we really were quite ideologically diverse. I mean, we had people from all different ideologies and races and perspectives and religions, and so that was a good thing. That was a good lesson.
Do you think that played out in the court? Do you think that had an impact on how the judge viewed your arguments?
I think it did. Judges are human, and each plaintiff executed a detailed affidavit that individual plaintiff wrote. I didn't just ghostwrite it for everyone. You know, these are smart kids. Most of them were undergrads. We had three law students in the group. And the judge could see that this wasn't just some right-wing cabal, but it really, spanned across all political views, and that was a good thing. And
that's really great. Yeah. Because, censorship really isn't a partisan issue. People censor who they disagree with, and that depends on who's in charge more than anything else.
No question. And, this prevailing orthodoxy that survives to this day on campus, I firmly believe, disadvantages the left liberal student more than the conservative. I mean, I emerged from Stanford with a solid education because my views were challenged on a daily basis, and I had to step up and defend them. Whereas, the leftist student, can emerge from 3 years of law school not being challenged much by faculty and it really ultimately hurts them more than us. And I say this as a kind of a libertarian leaning conservative myself. That's the irony of all this stuff. It helps the right and hurts the left students. But the other thing, and let me talk about the judge a little bit, because we got really lucky with our draw. And that
can you tell our listeners where the case was filed and the name of the case?
Yeah, we filed in state court, Santa Clara County Superior Court. Not federal court, because it was the Leonard Law, which was a state law, so we had to go to state court. And the case was Corry versus Stanford, Corry et al. Versus Leland Stanford Junior University. And we actually sued the president of Stanford, also the board of trustees. We sued the student conduct officer by name. We threw all these people in there, all in their official capacities, of course. We weren't seeking damages, monetary damages. All we wanted was an injunction.
And it was a facial challenge, because it wasn't in response to any sort of action, right?
Correct. And that was difficult, because we talked among ourselves, okay, who's going to go out there and actually violate the speech code and then have standing and defend? And, we went back and forth about that as a group, and, nobody was interested. And, we really, none of us wanted to engage in this hate speech. We didn't believe in it. And, so we weren't going to blatantly violate the speech code. And luckily we were able to file and maintain a purely facial challenge to it, because the speech code was, on its face, violated the First Amendment and also the Leonard Law. So as far as the judge, we got really lucky. Judge Peter Stone, who was a Jewish man who fled Nazi persecution in Hungary when he was a young boy, and then reached his way up to the Superior Court bench in California. And the interesting thing, and I don't think Stanford researched this judge very heavily like we did, the president of the university, Gerhard Casper, also immigrated from Germany. He was a young boy during Nazi times, and his approach to this lawsuit, his PR approach, was to say, "Well, I grew up in Germany, under the Nazi regime, and I'm well aware of how absolutes can be a bad thing, and these plaintiffs are First Amendment absolutists," which was true, but Casper was trying to criticize us for being First Amendment absolutists and using over and over this Nazi Germany analogy, which was totally misplaced and completely out of sorts.
Yeah, I saw he used that again in the response to your victory in the lawsuit.
Yeah, he did. And Nazi Germany, I'm sorry, did not have the First Amendment, anything like it. And, so the analogy was just totally misplaced. And this judge, you know, understood that far more than Gerhard Casper did.
Well, and, it was very impressive that he not only recognized that, but this was a lawsuit that had a number of hurdles, because you had to not only establish that the speech code would be unconstitutional, but you also had to establish that the Leonard Law, which applied those standards to private institutions, was itself constitutional.
Correct.
So you had a lot of ways you could have lost.
We sure could have, and Stanford did argue that point pretty well. Honestly, they put forth the decent argument that, you know, the Leonard Law actually violates our First Amendment, our meaning Stanford's First Amendment rights to, you know, set forth codes of conduct and that sort of thing, which is, there's something to that argument. I mean, I'm not saying they didn't have an argument, but
luckily the judge. I was recently rereading the case, and what impressed me most was how poorly that argument was made by Stanford, because they were talking about it in terms of their speech as opposed to their First Amendment right of freedom of association to pick what kind of community they wanted to have.
Right.
So
yeah, they didn't know how to make that argument. It didn't. The private sector arguments. They were mentally incapable of embracing that or contemplating it.
So to flesh this out, you know, to act as a devil's advocate for a second, the argument against the Leonard Law is that private institutions should enjoy the First Amendment freedom of association to pick what their community is like. And when you say in a statute that a private institution must allow anyone to speak their mind if they based on free speech principles, it is choosing one of the rights provided under the First Amendment to weigh heavier than the other right in the First Amendment. And so it's an interesting issue for people to wrap their head around and think about. But it wasn't really argued well in the case, and the court ends up deciding in the judgment that you won that the Leonard Law is perfectly constitutional.
Well said. I'm glad you weren't counsel for Stanford way back then. you might have struck down the Leonard Law. And there are good people on both sides of this. You know, after our victory, we were kind of riding high, and I had some inquiries from congressmen who wanted to pass a federal Leonard Law, you know, applying across the nation, and we worked with them a little bit. It went nowhere because of the arguments you bring up, I think. I mean, I think both
occasionally congressmen ask me about it, and I give them the pros and cons and let them make up their minds. And it's also an issue again in the news because after those riots at Berkeley University, the president went public about asking whether or not it would be appropriate to strip Berkeley of its federal funding.
That's right. And, you know, Berkeley, that was such an interesting situation because, I mean, that didn't just happen out of the blue. I mean, Berkeley had been fomenting this and creating this environment for many years.
Well, Bill Maher was subject to a disinvitation campaign there. And a few months earlier, there was a college Republican student who complained that he had been assaulted for having a cutout of then-candidate Trump in front of a Berkeley police officer who did nothing. So that was there's some seed sowing on that campus. And, you know, I should clarify to our listeners that Berkeley is a public institution, but the question that's similar to the Leonard Law that's presented at Berkeley is whether or not federal funds should be tied or public dollars should be tied to the First Amendment. They're currently not. A discrimination law, you know, has ties to federal funding, but the First Amendment doesn't.
But there is a section of the education code that talks about universities should respect free speech, and it doesn't directly tie it to federal funds, but I think a Department of Education could look at that and could make that linkage.
Yeah, there's been a sense of Congress that prioritizes the values of free speech in higher education that's passed and been renewed a couple times over the years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is for the benefit of our listeners here, 20 U.S. Code Section 1011A says it could be in the hands of a good Department of Education, which we may have here, could be a tool for progress. No student attending an institution of higher education should, on the basis of participation in protected speech or protected association, be excluded from participation and be denied the benefits of or be subjected to discrimination or official sanction under any education program, activity, or division of the institution directly or indirectly receiving financial assistance under this chapter. So this is federal law. One could say if a program is receiving indirect federal financial assistance, which is anything at any university, and they all receive federal financial assistance, if a student is subjected to official sanction, that program should not receive federal financial assistance. So I think there's already that in there.
I predict we're going to continue to have those conversations as controversies on campus heat up. But I want to return a little bit to the case. And I'm wondering, from your perspective, what you were more worried about when you were litigating it. Were you more worried about standing? Were you more worried about whether or not you'd be able to convince the court that the speech code was unconstitutional? Or were you worried about, you know, the application of the Leonard Law and whether or not they'd uphold that? And conversely, were you worried about none of it at all because you were really confident?
Well, I wouldn't say we were really confident. I mean, we were going up against top litigators that Stanford hired. David Heilbronn, who was former president of the California Bar Association, Harvard Law School grad, president of the Harvard Law Review when he was in law school. I mean, just highly credentialed, brilliant attorney. And you know, I was this third-year law student who had no clue my way around a courtroom and really didn't even know how to file a lawsuit. I mean, they didn't teach that at Stanford Law. File a lawsuit. But they did teach us, in the words of my torts professor, Bill Cohen, who was a principled opponent to the speech code. He said, well, we didn't teach you how to file a lawsuit, but we taught you how to check the rules. So we were not confident at all. And I think probably my biggest fear was I was just missing something, missing some procedural thing, missing some rule. You know, back in these days, we did not have internet. Al Gore had not yet invented the internet. So all of our research was the old-fashioned way, opening up a book. And, you know, you don't know whether you're missing something.
We have some young listeners, so why don't you explain books?
Yeah, it was right before. We didn't even have email back then. I mean, we had to literally print out this lawsuit and, you know, mail it into the court. So that was my biggest fear, that I was just missing some obvious thing, that things that lawyers know that non-lawyers don't know.
What about worries from, you know, backlash from the campus community? You had 8 co-plaintiffs here. Were you concerned? What was the response from the university community, from your fellow students, from your teachers and the administrators?
That's a great question. You know, the students were almost unanimously for us. I mean, I received very little negative blowback from my peers. And, you know, these are peers across the ideological spectrum. You know, free speech is just this issue that at the time, and maybe somewhat now, still brings people together. And, you know, we had the ACLU on our side, even though most of the plaintiffs were, you know, not ACLU type liberals. We had a few of them, but a lot of us were from the Stanford Review, not all of us. So we got good response from the students and even the faculty. You know, I would say the majority of them were encouraging me, giving me the thumbs up privately, and I understand why they couldn't do so publicly as faculty of Stanford. So good response there. And, you know, the media at the time understood the First Amendment and gave us positive coverage at all levels. I mean, we were on CNN. And
you were called the speech
news.
Code slayer in the Stanford Review.
That's right. Yeah, the Review wrote it up. I mean, they covered it, you know, in more detailed fashion than any other paper, because we were with that paper. But it was good response from people. And, you know, I was a little worried about suing the president and actually had to accept my diploma from him in person. He handed it to me, you know, plaintiff, and he's the defendant. But he was pretty gracious in person, you know. So that reaction was kind of a pleasant surprise. It was something we were worried about. We did care what people thought of us, and that was a nice thing.
Well, it's good to hear, because we have a lot of we hear from students all the time who are interested in challenging their university speech codes, and that's one of their main concerns is, you know, what's the response from my peers going to be? What's the response from the faculty members going to be? And in your case, it was pretty positive.
It was, and that is a valid concern. There's no question. You know, these students that are out there, they do care about what people think about them, and people should care. And, you know, that's a solid question to have. And I guess my answer to that is to go back to the real reasons why we have free speech. These are ideologically neutral principles that apply both ways. And, you know, if we were suppressing leftist speech on campus and 90% of the professors were registered Republicans and the prevailing orthodoxy was, you know, not to allow any leftist speech, I would hope that conservatives would come and defend leftists for their free speech if they were the ones under attack. And so if people in the future are bringing these types of challenges, keep the principles in mind, the neutral principles, and flip the ideologies involved. And one would hope that people could understand that defending all types of free speech, even though the perspectives that you don't have, can ultimately defend all perspectives.
Well said. I mean, I usually, you know, ask people to think through whether or not they'd be so quick to hand over the tools of censorship to their political adversaries. It's one thing to think that you yourself will be a enlightened censor, but you know, history has proven otherwise.
Yeah, I always ask people. I was like, "Who is the angel in society that you would nominate for the task of deciding what you can hear, what you can see, what you can read?" I don't know that I'd choose anyone in this world to decide for me what plays I can see, what books I can read, what music I can listen to. But
that's a good point. Let me ask you guys a question, because here's how things have changed. You know, back in my day in law school, nobody really argued with a straight face that the notion of free speech or issue of freedom or, you know, these principles are inherently themselves racist and sexist and, you know, the tool of the ruling class to oppress everyone else. Nowadays, I mean, you hear this argument all the time where, you know, otherwise intelligent, credible people come in and say, well, we shouldn't even have free speech. It's just a tool of the white male and the oppressor. That's an argument I honestly, I'm not sure how I persuade that person or even try to. And I know you guys deal with this all the time.
Well, that's a great question. And we're always trying to give a better and better answer to it. You know, I think that they're just wrong and don't recognize how vital free speech has been to literally every civil rights advancement in our history. And I think that one, you know, thing that we can do about it is to make sure that we, you know, eliminate these speech codes, because I think that as we see the calls for censorship, they're often coming from a perspective of people who feel like their voices haven't been heard. And I think that they're misguided in the approach that they're taking. but making sure that all of the lawful avenues for speaking out are open to them, and seeing them and letting them see how valuable free speech is as a tool, and experience that for themselves is the way we're going to change that attitude over time.
Yeah, one of the things that's concerning to me is a lot of these students, rightfully or so or not, are concerned that their administrations or their institutions of power are oppressing them in one way or another, or marginalizing them in one way or another. But these, in some cases, are students who are also asking that their administrations adopt speech codes, and those, you know, who would be responsible for enforcing those speech codes on campus? Those same institutions of power that these students are concerned about abusing that power. So even if you disagree with free speech from a moral standpoint, at least from a tactical perspective, you should approve of it. But I want to close up here, because I know you're a busy man and I don't want to keep you too long. This week is the anniversary, the 22nd anniversary of the decision in the case, which came down on February 27th, 1995. And you guys won almost across the board and eliminated a speech code that affected more than 13,000 undergraduates, or no, 13,000 students as a whole, 6,500 undergraduates. How did you first hear about the victory?
Well, let's see. I was a staff attorney with the Pacific Legal Foundation at the time in Sacramento, and I believe somebody from the LA Times called me and said, "Do you know that this came down?"
They scooped you.
A comment. Yeah, I had no idea, because going back to, you know, at the time, the court would have mailed me the decision, like United States Mail. So I didn't know about it at the time. And then the LA Times, or some newspaper, I don't know if it was them or maybe the San Francisco Chronicle, faxed me the lengthy decision. Yes, we did use fax machines back then, some, and we don't use those much anymore. But that is how I found out about it.
And it was covered everywhere. I mean, there was write-ups in the New York Times. For a state court decision, it had a big national impact.
It
at least
did.
As far as the narrative went. And you also happened to prove Abraham Lincoln wrong, who said that he who represents himself has a fool for a client. You had a resounding victory and proved him wrong.
Well, that was the interesting thing, too, you know, because we put so much effort into this. I mean, we really, and it was mostly Scott Cooper, another plaintiff who was also a law student, and I did most of the law work. You know, because we were the law students.
Are you still in touch with your co-plaintiffs?
Some of them, yeah. I was actually out at Stanford last month for a Stanford Review reunion, which was a blast, and saw a few of them out there. Aman Virgi, he's still very involved with the review. He was one of our co-plaintiffs, and that was nice to see a lot of the folks from way back. I'm not in touch with all of them, but it would be interesting to have some sort of reunion or something at some point for the plaintiffs.
What would you say to other students that are considering challenging their university's speech codes?
I would say do it. I would say go for it, because looking back on my law career, you know, I've handled some very interesting cases and done some interesting things, but this was one of the most interesting things I've ever done as an attorney. And we were on the right side, too,
so
no question.
And we love it. But one of the things we wanted to ask you before we let you go is, what are you up to these days? My understanding is you have a pretty fascinating legal practice out in Colorado, and wanted to give you a chance to tell our listeners about it.
We do. I run a small law firm based in Denver, and we've kind of carved out a leadership role in Colorado's newest cash crop and the industry surrounding it, cannabis, which has been exciting, you know. And I attribute a lot of our creativity and the firm's success for what we accomplished at Stanford, and the fact that, you know, we came out of Stanford with an open mind, and we sued our university, and that took a little bit of courage, and taking on this cannabis issue required some courage as an attorney, too.
Well, you know, the Corry decision, you know, could be a career high for anyone, but it sounds like you have other highs coming.
And well, the decision wasn't appealed, right? We should say that. We skipped over that.
Stanford did not appeal it. And I two reasons for that, I think. Number one, the judge got it right, the trial court judge, and he really put the effort into it, which you don't see from every trial court judge, at least I haven't in the 20 years I've been practicing since then. But this judge put the hard effort into it. I think he wrote it himself. I don't think a state court judge in California has a cadre of clerks or anything. So that was one reason Stanford didn't appeal, because he was right, and they probably thought their prospects of success were small. The other reason is the PR. I mean, they got tons of negative PR from alums and the media, top to bottom. This was a bad thing for Stanford. It was a bad move for their image and a bad move for a great international research university to have a speech code that prevents people from saying things.
Well, the case for free speech is a powerful one, and it's one that we rely on every day at FIRE.
Yeah, you guys are doing great work out there.
All right, Rob, we're going to let you go. Rob Corry, speech code slayer, thanks for joining us on the show.
Thank you for joining us, and again, thank you for that compliment.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having me.
If you are a student or faculty member who is interested in challenging your school's speech codes in court, visit standupforspeech.com or email standup@thefire.org to learn how we at the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education can help you. This podcast is hosted and produced by me, Nico Perino, and recorded and edited by Aaron Reese. To learn more about So to Speak, you can follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/freespeechtalk or like us on Facebook at facebook.com/so2speakpodcast. You can also email us feedback@sotospeak@thefire.org or call in a question for a future show at 215-315-0100. Until next time, thanks for listening.